Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. Sorry, I thought I was having an echo in the microphone or something, but that's right. It's lovely to be back amongst you again this morning. I was away on holiday last week. My wife and I were on leave and we were down in Derbyshire seeing some members of her family who, for obvious reasons, we haven't seen for quite a while. So it was nice to be away, but it's always lovely to be back. Apart from the weather's not been any good to get washing done, but that's what I'm on about every week, so you'll be well used to hearing my usual grumbles. Particularly warm welcome this morning to Church for anyone who's here either for the first time in a while or who's visiting with us today. We will be continuing to look at the five marks of mission this morning, and particularly to number three, to respond to human needs by acts of loving service. And it's therefore appropriate that during the service today, we'll be taking time to dedicate the members and work of the Guild in Faifley Parish Church. And you'll be hearing their voices at varying times in the service this morning. We are, however, here to worship God, and we'll do just exactly that with our opening hymn, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty and loving God, we thank you for the assurance we have that you are always with us, that in you we will find help and strength in times of trouble, that whatever we face, you will always be there to reach out and save us. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. We thank you that you are present not only here but everywhere, that no one is outside your love and no place beyond your concern. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. We thank you that you hold firmly to us even when we try and struggle from your grasp, and your mercy never runs dry, despite our repeated faithlessness. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. We thank you that your patience is never exhausted, no matter how many times we let you down. So now we worship you, you who alone are God, worthy of all praise and honour. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. We come with gladness and thanksgiving, joy and celebration. We come in awe and wonder, hope and faith. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. Almighty and loving God, take our faith, weak though it is, kindle the sparks of life within us, and fan a new flame of love within our hearts. And so may we set out into another week with a new purpose, resolved to live and work for you, in the assurance that you are with us, now and always. Great is your faithfulness from one generation to another. Amen.
Thank you, Margaret. And Dorothy's going to do this in her gospel reading.
The gospel reading is from Matthew chapter 9, verses 18 to 26. Jesus raises a dead girl and heals a sick woman. While he was saying this, a synagogue leader came and knelt before him and said, "My daughter has just died, but come and put your hand on her and she will live." Jesus got up and went with him, and so did his disciples. Just then a woman who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak. She said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be healed." Jesus turned and saw her. "Take heart, daughter," he said. "Your faith has healed you," and the woman was healed at that moment. When Jesus entered the synagogue leader's house and saw the noisy crowd and the people playing pipes, he said, "Go away, this girl is not dead but asleep." But they laughed at him. After the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took the girl by her hand, and she got up. News of this spread through all that region. Amen.
And so we see problems. Too numerous to mention and to outline, but they fill many common column inches over the course of every single week. The good news is that we are here to act positively and give positively to the lives of others. And number three is another one of the ways we can do this. Already we have been empowered to teach and this week to tend, and there's still two more good ways to live as a church in a parish. But number three is calling us to act on behalf of others in their need. Now, right now, and throughout the whole pandemic, our own project, the upcycling room recycling, has been open to receive and to give goods on request, and nearly every Tuesday the door has been open for folks to come as far as the threshold and ask for the things that they need. But that is very directly a project that answers human need. There are people in want, and our project says, tell us, and if we're able, we'll answer it. Within the limits of what's already been given, and I'm always amazed at this, that those who are volunteers with the upcycling room can remember where everything is, where those curtains are, where that pair of shoes went, where that winter jacket is that will fit this lady, this gent. What a capacity for memory. We are answering human need. Summer and winter, in wet and dry, sometimes with the gazebo up outside the church on a Tuesday morning because of the rain, but you know the Lord blesses Faifley. I can tell you and prove how. Because nearly every Tuesday morning is dry enough to put the tables out. And when it's not dry, it just reminds me to say, thank you, Lord, for last Tuesday, and next Tuesday it'll be dry, won't it? And be grateful for that. It answers human need. And we have, at the same time, our partnership with the Community Council in the food share, answering that other, more basic human need for food. And it answers those who are anxious in a time of crisis and are fearful of job loss, or even with furlough, that cut that came to income. And now the fear of price hikes in heating and the cut of that £20 from Universal Credit, and the worry about what might happen in the economy, has already in a couple of weeks seen a 25% rise in the number of people looking for a parcel. We are answering human needs in this church. But it's not just those two very public, outward-facing, at-the-door projects that are doing that. And this morning, we know exactly who else is doing this. The Guild is doing this. You have your Guild projects that answer the needs of men and women, boys and girls in this country and overseas. In Christ's name, and if only because of our discipleship to Jesus. For sight and knowledge and understanding of how human need in poverty and health and social position can be answered. Tomorrow night, this is the intonation coming early, tomorrow night Michaela Foster Marsh will come as a guest speaker and will be describing the work of Star Child in Uganda, a project that helps young people there. I'm not going to say any more than that because you're going to hear about it tomorrow far better from Michaela. But there's an example of not just our guild, but the guild nationally picking up on the work of our charity in one nation. But as somebody who is here this morning would tell us, on the sight of a million starfish washed up on the shore, one person picking one up, dropping it back in the waves. But you can't possibly get them all back in. Nope. But everyone I help is back where it should be and safe. You recognise that story anyway? I'll bet you do. Friends, we can't do everything, and we don't have to. We have to recognise from the story that was read from the Gospel this morning that we have a story with two people. Just count that again. Just make sure. Two people. A woman with our chronic bleeding, which meant she could not attend temple worship, synagogue worship. She was ritually impure because of that and couldn't participate as an observant Jew in the festivals. And it had been years long. Take heart, daughter. Your faith has healed you. And then, the girl who we normally would call Jairus' daughter from the other Gospels, lifted, and the eyes open, not dead but alive. And the news of this spread through all that region. I know that people who have not been at either door on a Tuesday morning speak of what we are doing as a church. I know that people have noticed that Monday night is busy again. The car park is full. What's going on a Monday night? Well, is that not just an invitation to say, that's mainly, not solely, the women of our church who meet in friendship, who meet in worship, but they also meet to hear about organisations that are working at home and abroad, and all of that because they're Christians. And yes, a couple of men go. This is news of our church. There's other news to tell, and it answers different needs. Our boys' brigade is ready to help young men and women. Young men, beg your pardon. We're only young men so far. Young men grow up and taking on responsibility and learning and participating with each other and hearing too about our Lord Jesus in the devotions that open the evening with the boys. Brownies is coming back. It's not here yet. I'm not saying this week, Chloe, but it's coming back. There is a plan, and we'll be glad to see Caroline and the helpers welcoming and helping girls know how to learn about the world and one another and their place in it. And it should be news that we've had a regular prayer meeting through lockdown and continues online, and those who are there just get used to seeing each other, and that strangeness of months ago praying as if you're praying to a television screen has gone, and we know that we're praying together for men and women with needs, health needs, crises in their life. That should be news. It is when I get asked, how's church just now? It's great. We meet on a Sunday. The guild is back. The boys' brigade's online. The prayer group still keeps going. All these things to get spoken of should be your news as well. And it should be encouraging you to think, okay, great, those things are happening, but I'm not involved. Well, you can be. You can be. You can be at the guild on a Monday evening. It accepts men and women as members, and you can be involved in hearing the work of projects that are on a national and international footing, organised through the Guild nationally. You can fundraise for that, learn about them further. And if you're sitting there thinking, yep, well, the church is all doing fine things, I'm all happy with that, but I just wish somebody would start looking after, well, something you're passionate about, then the good news is, have a word in that ear. You might have to put your hand on that side so it stays in, okay? Just get it in that ear. And if you are ready to say you'll be involved, then we'll see if we can do it. Because there is no end to human need. No end at all. And there is capacity in these buildings and among us to answer human need. Because Jesus did. But on this day, how many did we hear being healed? In this story, two. We will not answer every need, but none of us should be counted out of being involved in loving service. The marks of mission remind us that our church has roles to proclaim the message whenever it can be told, to baptize and nurture new believers last week. But this week, the call is for all of us. And it doesn't have to be by organization. It can simply be by you acting in love, patience, kindness, and respect. Loving service given to your neighbors in need of these things. There is no reason not to broaden our capacity to serve our neighbors. There is no reason for you ever to be stuck, for someone to serve in Jesus' name. And why? Well, Jeremiah reminded us that if you pray for the city to prosper, then all goes well for everyone. The city benefits, the believers benefit. If loving service answers human need, then God is in empowering us, and God is changing lives among us. Amen. Our next hymn this morning is one chosen for the theme. Our first hymn was chosen because it's a favourite of Mary McIntosh, who is one of our senior guild members. We'll put it that way, Mary. So we sang your hymn, now we're singing a hymn that touches on the theme of service to others. We cannot measure how you heal.
Thank you.
We come now to our prayer of thanksgiving and offering, dedication of the offering. Let's pray together. Eternal God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we dedicate our lives and the gifts we offer from our daily living, because we know that our lives rightfully belong to you, and that everything we have we hold in trust from you. We praise you for everything you have done for us. Help us and all Christ's people to live and speak the good news of your love, so that all human life finds fulfillment and flourishes in you, especially our own lives, which can be an offering to you. Use what we offer of ourselves and our resources to create a Christ-led humanity in our world and in our hearts. All this we ask in and through the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, the first intimation doesn't need a whole explanation. The Guild meets tomorrow night at 7:15 and welcomes Michaela Foster-Marsh to talk about the Guild project, which she heads up, Star Charter. The prayer group meets at 7 p.m. on Thursday evening. So remember that you can always give us any request that you have, a person or a situation that you would like to know was being prayed for. Next Sunday, we're going to dedicate the presence of the defibrillator to its capacity for saving lives, and pray that it will be of use to our community. There'll then be an opportunity taken to take some photographs around it to promote the work of St John's Scotland, who provided the defibrillator for us, that we can help them promote defibrillators inside Clyde Bank. A week on Tuesday, there is an event in Paisley, face-to-face with Michael Harvey. Do you remember Back to Church Sunday? Well, Back to Church Sunday's main man, Michael Harvey, has redeveloped that into a weekend of welcome, but he's also been very influential in creating what's called the ACORN program. And the ACORN program is an encouragement and a growing movement across Scotland, an encouragement for congregational members to gently share faith among friends and family members, mostly by doing exactly the kind of things that you know and are comfortable doing, which is reaching out in friendship and then praying for what you've heard. This event in Paisley on the 2nd of November week on Tuesday, I would love to have some members going. I'd love to have a couple of people that would say they would go, they would find out about it, they would be able to come back and tell us about it. I'm very keen that every program and opportunity does not take me to drive it, although I might get the email that finds it. If you might be thinking, that could be me, then you'll meet a very able communicator. You'll meet a number of other Christian folks in Paisley in our presbytery who will be just as interested in you to find out why the ACORN program is growing throughout Scotland and has been backed by the General Assembly. Those are our intimations this week. Thank you, Steve. Guild dedication.
As we've been hearing all morning, as I mentioned at the beginning, and Greg has just said just now, the members of the Guild are here this morning to be rededicated to the work that they do. The Church of Scotland Guild is a movement within the Kirk which invites and encourages both women and men to commit their lives to Jesus Christ, and enables them to express their faith in worship, prayer, and action. Can I ask the members of the Guild, if able, to please stand? And can I ask you to respond to the following question with "I do"? Do you, as individual members of the Guild, dedicate yourselves to Christ Jesus, whose you are and whom you serve, and in doing so, look forward in faith, fellowship, and worship, offering yourselves as lights from under the bushel to the church and your community? Thank you. God bless you in the work that you do. Please be seated. And let's come together, all together, in prayer. Lord, we lay before you our concerns for others, our concerns for the world. We pray for your church here in Scotland and throughout the world, and we ask that you will sustain and bless all who, by their words and actions, seek to spread the good news to all people. We pray for harmony amongst all who follow the way of Jesus Christ, and for all to be united in their aim to serve you and do your will. We ask, Lord, your blessing on the Guild and the projects they support at home and abroad. Guide and inspire all who plan for the future, and encourage those who deal with the day-to-day tasks which make it all possible. At this time, Lord, we also pray for the leaders of nations, communities, industry, and the caring services, and we ask that each will use their influence wisely and with compassion, so that all they do is acceptable to you. We pray for peace, for the healing of quarrels and disputes within families, between nations, within nations. We offer our prayers for peace throughout the world, for an epidemic of love to sweep through nations. Lord, at this time we pray for all who are ill, for those who have physical pain, for those who suffer mental torment. And we remember those who, because of advancing years, are frustrated because their activities are curtailed. We pray for the bereaved, those trying to rebuild their lives after the loss of one for whom they cared dearly, but who face constant reminders that there is a gap which cannot be filled. Heavenly Father, there are many who have secret sorrows and anxieties which they feel they cannot share with others. May all who are weary and burdened with a load of care find comfort in the knowledge that you know their worries and that you are always with them. These prayers we make in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour. Amen. We close our worship this morning with the hymn "Called to Act Justly."
Thank you.
Let us go to serve God as beacons of light to guide others to him, putting the Lord first in all that we do. And as we go, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Copies if you wish to pick one up on the way out. Friends, can I ask those on door duty today just to make their way to their places to serve spots? Thank you, Richard. Ready at massive?